السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him, his family members, his companions, to bless every one of us, to grant us goodness, and to accept all the supplications we will be making, we are making during this month of Ramadan and beyond. Ameen. My brothers, my sisters, yesterday we were speaking about Surah Al-Fatiha and I explained how important it is. I will be continuing with the surah, but I need to recap for those who might have missed it. Firstly, we will all call out to Allah. We all have needs that Allah has placed. We all have things that we want. We must call out to Allah. We must understand that Allah alone is the one we seek help from. So, how do we call out to Allah? Number one, we seek forgiveness for all the sins we've committed, those we know, those we don't know. We declare the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We declare our helplessness. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if we could, it would be best to have done a good deed just prior to calling out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether you gave out a charity, whether you were good in some way, you did some form of obedience, or even you abstained from some prohibition that the Almighty has considered or declared prohibited. Then, after declaring the praise of Allah and sending blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we now call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we're finished calling out to Allah, in that dua, we should not have any sin. No, so you don't ask Allah to facilitate a sin for you, whether it is the destroying of relations, between people, yourself and someone you're supposed to be connected to, etc. Rather, you ask Allah to solve the matters, the problems. So when you have a problem with a person, don't say, "Oh Allah, destroy them," but you should say, "Oh Allah, help us to resolve the matter, guide them, open the doors." Those are blessed du'as. Qati'atu rahim is a term used in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, referring to the breaking of family ties. We should not make a dua where we are asking for the breaking of family ties. That's something that the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned. It's a very powerful point. Many people forget about it, because when we call out to Allah, a lot of the times people just say, "Oh Allah, break that one, destroy this one, I don't want to see this one," etc. Let's not do that. You say, "Oh Allah, guide them, soften them," and keep on making the dua and repeat it and keep on repeating the dua, because that is definitely part and parcel of the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Repetition of a dua is very, very important. Repeat it in the morning, in the afternoon, in the season, off the season. When I say in the season, I mean during the blessed days, the blessed nights, and even outside of it. Don't wait and don't delay. Keep repeating it. Let's get to Surah Al-Fatiha. The hadith in Sahih Muslim tells us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds at every verse of Surah Al-Fatiha, and He has said, "I've divided the surah into two." There are seven verses in the surah. The first three belong to Allah, the other three belong to the human being, belong to the worshipper, and the middle one is divided exactly half. So half for Allah and half for the worshipper. How? When we say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, "My worshipper has declared my praise." When we say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the most forgiving or the most beneficent, the most merciful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Athna alayya abdi," which means my worshipper has declared my praise in a different way. I declared my praise. When we say Maliki Yawmiddin, which means owner of the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Majjadani abdi," my worshipper has declared my majesty, my greatness. And for my worshipper is whatever he wants. And Allah keeps on saying, "For my worshipper is whatever he asks for." Right at the beginning, according to one of the narrations, Allah says, "I have divided Surah Al-Fatiha between myself and my worshipper into two, and for my worshipper is whatever he wants." When the first verse is read again, according to one of the narrations, He says, "And for my worshipper is whatever he wants." When we say Iyyaka na'budu wa Iyyaka nasta'in, you alone we worship, you alone we seek help from, Allah says, "This is between myself and my worshipper, and for my worshipper is whatever he's going to ask me, whatever he asks me." Imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, "This is between myself and my worshipper," which means him and I, or him and you, "and for you is whatever you are going to ask for." What's the first thing you're going to ask for? The most powerful thing that you and I can ever ask for. And Allah has instructed us to keep repeating this in every unit of prayer. It was enough for us to ask for it once, and He tells us, fine, I've given it to you. But in order to keep reminding us to say, this is something you desperately need and you need to work towards it, I will give it to you, but work hard to achieve it as well. That is, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Guide us to the straight path. Wow. Subhanallah. Guidance is the most important dua and prayer supplication you could ever make. That's why we are forced. We have to repeat that dua. Your salah, your prayer that is compulsory upon you 5 times a day. It will not be accepted unless you have read Surah Al-Fatiha in it, unless you have called out to Allah for guidance. Guide us to the straight path, O Allah. Guide us to the straight path. My brothers and sisters, let's keep on asking Allah for guidance. And it's not good enough to ask Allah for something and you're heading in a different direction. Imagine you say to someone, please take me to Canada. And suddenly you find yourself catching a flight to go to Australia. I mean, where are you going? What did you ask for? When you had the chance, you were not serious about what you were asking. You were not desperately asking for something and seeking for it. You were actually somewhere else, asking for one thing and doing another. So when you ask for guidance, be serious. You're reminded about this question that you're asking Allah, or the supplication. You're reminded about it by its repetition. Every single prayer, it's being repeated. This is Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, guide us to the straight path. You see how the first 3.5 verses, Allah, and then iyyaka nasta'in, which means you alone we seek help from, and here we are asking you for guidance. This is now all the other 3.5 verses connected to the worshipper and what he wants, we're going to give him. It's just one dua, one supplication, guide us to the straight path. The rest of the verses are connected, the other 2 verses are connected to a description of what this particular supplication has in it. Guide us to the straight path. So what is the straight path? Like how when Allah says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, all praise is due to Allah, Lord of the worlds. One might say, who is the Lord of the worlds? So Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim is a description of who the Lord of the worlds is. Maliki Yawmiddin is a description of who the Lord of the worlds is. So in the same way that part of the surah was divided in order to describe Allah, this part is divided in order to describe what you're asking for. I want to be guided to the straight path. So what is the straight path? The path of those whom you have favored. Subhanallah, amazing, amazing, amazing. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. The path of those whom you have favored, you have bestowed your favor upon. غير المغضوب عليهم. Not those whom you are angry with. ولا الضالين. Not those who have lost the path. So, O Allah, guide us to that path of those whom you had favored, not the ones you became angry with, not the ones who lost the way. And then we all say, Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the beauty of this dua, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors in a way that we actually appreciate. That for Allah to make us repeat a dua constantly, it has to be the most important dua in existence. Because if you have guidance, you have everything. Guide us to the straight path. You ask Allah for guidance in every aspect of yours. Yeah, and this is when the Almighty would actually, be pleased with us when we have called out to Him and we are trying to work also in the same direction. I want to move on in this beautiful series of supplications from Revelation. I move on to the supplications of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I start off with this, or it's the second thing. The first was Surah Al-Fatiha. I felt it was the most important. A lot of the scholars who've spoken about supplications from Revelation have started off with Surah Al-Fatiha. And it's correct because Allah started the whole Quran with Surah Al-Fatiha. It was revealed more than once to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it happens to be in the order of the Quran right at the beginning. It's known as the opening. In Surah Al-Fatiha, there is such powerful, powerful words of supplication. In fact, if you're asking Allah to guide you to the straight path, that is guidance. The first of it is
guidance towards Allah, guidance towards that which is correct, guidance towards that which is upright, guidance towards that which is beneficial, guidance towards that which is going to be filled with contentment and happiness. So Surah Al-Fatiha, in it, there are so many beautiful, beautiful aspects that we would be achieving just by calling out to Allah. And when we get to the prophets of Allah, remember, I gave you the example in the first episode of this series where I said, when you have a combination lock and someone's given you the numbers or told you, look, this number will work, that number will work, and you're busy trying all other numbers, perhaps you might stumble across a number that may work in one of the locks or on one of the locks. But if you're already told certain numbers, rather use those numbers. The chances of you getting through are far greater than if you were to start afresh and, you know, say words that have not yet been tested. But still, we are allowed to obviously call out to Allah. In fact, I want to give you good news. The good news is that Allah knows what you want to call out with or what you want to ask Him, even if you haven't said it. And even if you are unable to communicate it in the proper way, Allah knows it, because Allah knows what's in the hearts. But He wants your tongue to bear witness. He wants you to try. He wants you to say something. He wants you to engage in an act of worship known as the utterance, the saying. So that is why it's important to also try your best to say. You know, when a child wants something, you know what the child wants, but you want the child to say things sometimes. So it's so cute, isn't it? And you say, oh Allah, imagine you're a big man. You're a person who has a lot, authority, power, wealth, and you're calling out to Allah. That's the height of goodness in terms of bestowment by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you. It's amazing. So my brothers and sisters, the more you have in terms of material wealth and power, authority, if you become more humble, you're actually closer to Allah, because you have shown that whatever I have is not going to actually help me if it is not for the mercy of Allah. So we call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always. And this is why we look at the prophets of Allah. They were chosen by Allah. They were told that you are chosen, but they still called out to Allah. They cried to Allah. You sit and look at the Prophet, peace be upon him, calling out to Allah. He's the best of creation, the most noble of prophets, the highest of all, the, you know, totally amazing position granted to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that no one else was granted, shall be granted. And here he is calling out to Allah. Those words need to be studied by every one of us. That's why we have an entire series for the whole month of Ramadan. It's a month of dua. It's not just the month of the Quran. It's not just the month of giving. It's also the month of supplication. So when we speak about supplications from revelation in the month of Ramadan, we have in it a lot. Revelation is from Allah, the month of Ramadan. Supplication is for Allah, the month of Ramadan. And it's obviously for our benefit. We're calling out to Allah. When we bring the two together, we have a study of the dua that we should be engaging in this month from the revelation that was also revealed in this month. And it is the month of the study of the revelation. So these are the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I want to start off with a dua made by Adam alayhi salam, the first of our species. Allah created him. Allah made him. Allah told him, I have raised you in rank above the others. Subhanallah. Some became jealous. You know, Iblis became jealous. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Allah favors Adam alayhi salam by telling him, here in this paradise. And what was the paradise? There are different narrations. They say it was not the same paradise that we will be going back to at the end, but it was a part of the paradise, a special part of the paradise that was made in order for the fulfillment of what Allah wanted to achieve. So some call it Jannatul Ibtila, which means it was the gardens. You know, Jannah means a garden. So it was the gardens of Eden, those which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created in order for the testing of Adam, special place. But it was considered Jannah. So this is just an opinion. There is another opinion saying, no, it was one and the same thing. All these are opinions, but it's interesting to mention them just to know. However, in essence, we firmly believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam. He was in Jannah. You know, we don't need to get into the debate about where the Jannah and how and what. But if you'd like to know the opinions, it's interesting. And Allah told him one thing. Don't eat from this tree. In fact, لا تقربا هذه الشجرة. You and your spouse, don't come close to the tree. So I remember someone asking me, did Allah instruct him not to eat the fruit or not to go close to the tree? And I said, Allah instructed him both instructions. It's like zina, adultery. Allah says, لا تقربوا الزنا. Don't even get close to adultery. Why does Allah say don't get close to adultery? Because it means everything that leads up to it is also prohibited. May Allah safeguard us. May Allah protect us. So there is no point in a person coming to say, well, Allah said, you know, don't get close to it, but He didn't prohibit it. That's foolish. The same would apply when it comes to Adam alayhi salam. If someone says, la taqraba hadhihi shajara, means don't get close to the tree, but you know, who said you're not allowed to eat from the fruit? If Allah says don't get close to the tree, not eating from the fruit is included in that. So there are ahadith where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the fruit. In fact, the fact that Allah makes mention in the Quran later on, فَأَكَلَا مِنْهَا, they ate from it, already shows that the prohibition included eating from it. You were not allowed to eat from it. But unfortunately, for a reason best known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His divine wisdom, Adam alayhi salam ate from it. He committed a sin, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He had it in this huge plan to show us humankind that when we falter, what we should be doing. In order for that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed Adam alayhi salam to perpetrate this sin and immediately regret it. So my brothers and sisters, when you and I commit a sin and we are human, we will, we have, we shall. Remember, when you regret the sin, it is a sign that you believe in Allah. Subhanallah. Whatever you've done, no matter how old you are, no matter what gender you are, no matter where you come from, your race, whatever you have done against Allah's instruction, if it makes you regret, you still have a lot of hope in the mercy of Allah. It's a sign of iman. إِذَا سَرَّتْكَ حَسَنَتُكَ وَسَاءَتْكَ سَيِّئَتُكَ فَأَنْتَ مُؤْمِنٌ. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in one narration says, when your good deed makes you happy, makes you calm, makes you feel good, and when your bad deed makes you regret, then you're a true believer. It shows that you believe in Allah. That's why you're regretting the sin. That's why you're feeling good about the good deed you did. If you didn't regret it, it means you've got no one you're answerable to. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves it when you regret your sin. You committed something, you drank alcohol, you had a bit of a drug, may Allah safeguard all of us. Whatever wrong you've done, immediately thereafter you say, astaghfirullah, I shouldn't have done this. Astaghfirullah, may Allah forgive me, I shouldn't have done this. So you regret it, you feel remorse. That's what happened to Adam alayhi salam. Then he said a few words unto Allah. In one verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He taught him some words. And in another verse, Allah says, تَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. You see, the words were taught by Allah, they were repeated by Adam alayhi salam, and he said these words. What were these words? Subhanallah. These are some of the most powerful words. We all need these words. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَّمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Oh Allah, oh our Rabb. You know, oh our Rabb, رَبَّنَا. Oh our Rabb. What is the meaning of Rabbun? Rabb is the one who created you in the first place and who has absolute control of every aspect of your existence. He's called Rabbun. All your growth depends totally on Him. Your food, your sustenance, your health, whatever. You know, He nourishes, cherishes, provides, protects and cures, etc., etc. That's Rabbun. So that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rabbana, oh our Rabb, oh our Rabb. Sometimes if you're alone, you can say Rabbi, Rabbi meaning my Rabb. And Rabbi without the Ya also refers to my Rabb. Because in the Arabic language, you are allowed to drop that Ya when it comes to Rabbun, Rabbi. So here he says, Rabbana, Zalamna, we have oppressed Anfusana, ourselves. We have wronged ourselves. Oh Allah, we are the ones who perpetrated a sin. We committed a crime. We did something wrong. We did something we were not supposed to do. That is the meaning of Zalamna Anfusana. وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا, and if you are not going to forgive us, وَتَرْحَمْنَا, and if you are not going to have mercy on us, لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ, we are the ones who will definitely be the losers. You're not going to lose anything, we will lose. That dua is seeking forgiveness of Allah. It's the proper way of asking Allah's forgiveness. It was taught to Adam alayhi salam by Allah. It was repeated by Adam alayhi salam. Allah forgave him as a result, but he was sincere, there was remorse, and he did not do it again. Do we ever get a narration that says, astaghfirullah, it's not there, but I'm just saying for argument's sake, that Adam alayhi salam went back to the tree, said, hang on, it was so tasty, let me go back and have some more. Never, never. It happened once, it never happened again. May Allah strengthen us. I want to give you good news. The good news is that we as human beings sometimes go back to the same sin that we've sought forgiveness from genuinely. What happens then? Well, if you sought forgiveness genuinely and you were really asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you really regretted it and you really promised Allah you're not going to do it again, then that tawbah or that seeking of forgiveness was accepted and Allah forgave you and your sin was wiped out completely. And when you committed it again later on without having planned it at the time that you sought forgiveness previously, Allah will consider that a totally separate deed. It's not something connected to the previous sin, even though it was a repetition. That's the mercy of Allah. So keep asking forgiveness again and again and again. No matter how many times you end up committing that sin, every time it will be considered and looked at as something totally separate from the previous one, because the previous one was totally wiped out. You regretted it. You asked Allah's forgiveness. You promised not to do it again. Allah wiped the sin out, and there we go. What great mercy of Allah. So my brothers and sisters, you see the supplication that we have for today is the supplication of Adam alayhi salam and Hawa alayha salatu wassalam. These were our forefathers, the first of our species. They also faltered. Don't lose hope when you falter. Many people ask me a question, you know, I think I've committed so many sins. I think I'm beyond repair. You're not beyond repair. I think I've done so much. I'm an evil person. You're not an evil person. The fact that there is a flicker of that candle within and you want to come out, that's enough. You need to come out. You need to seek Allah's forgiveness. He will wipe out no matter what you've done. The most powerful dua you could have after Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim is to seek the forgiveness of Allah. Oh Allah, forgive me for the sins I've committed, those which I know, those which I don't know, and those that were major, those that were minor. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. So I'd like to repeat this dua.
ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين.
Oh our Rabb, we have wronged ourselves. And if you don't forgive us and if you don't have mercy upon us, we will be the ones who will definitely be the losers. Subhanallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we forgave Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. As a result, the consequence was he had to come onto earth. But the good thing is all his offspring, including you and I, were taught how to seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine to this day, we are taught how to seek the forgiveness of Allah. Had it not been for that act of Adam alayhi salam, we would never have known how to seek the forgiveness of Allah. Or perhaps there would have been someone else who would have come. And this is the way of Allah. Allah knows we are human and Allah wanted to forgive us. Like Allah says in the Quran, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allah definitely wants to forgive you. But it's shaitan who wants us to go astray. So we definitely would like to continue calling out to Allah. You know, when it comes to the messengers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Anbiya says, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ. They used to do a lot of good deeds. وَيَدْعُونَنَا رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا. And they used to call out to us, hoping and being fearful. Inshallah, tomorrow or in the next episode, we will be getting to the meaning of this verse that I just mentioned right now at the end of this episode. But in the meantime, I hope you've enjoyed today. I hope we take lessons from today. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ وَبَارَكَ عَلَى نَبِيْنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ